Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Now, usually after an introduction like that, there's a question that pops up in people's minds, and I want to get it out of the way so you're not sitting there thinking about this through the whole conversation, the whole presentation itself. So first of all, the painter, no relationship to him. The virus, I didn't do it. You can't blame me for it. I was too young at the time. Okay, so I'm lying there. You caught me. And the turtles, I think they're shooting on location somewhere for a new movie. So we've got that all out of the way. Now, I'd like to get serious for a second and tell you a little story. I went to the doctor about a year ago, and the doctor said, you're at that age now, I want you to drink 8 glasses of water a day. I said, 8 glasses? He said, yes, 8 glasses. And after about 6 months, I mean, I'm an overachiever. I'm drinking 12 to 16 bottles of water a day. And after about 6 months, my stomach started to bother me. So I went to the doctor, and I said, hey, you know, my stomach's bothering me. And the doctor said, well, you know, are you drinking the water? I said, yeah, I'm like having 12 to 16 bottles a day. He said, 12 to 16 bottles? I said, yes. He said, do you know what's in the bottles? I said, yeah, water. He said, no. Do you know what's in the water? I said, yeah, 2 hydrogen, 1 oxygen. And he said, well, no, I mean, what's really in the water? Do you know what magnesium sulfate is? Well, I was a chemistry major when I was in college, and I said, MgSO4. He said, no, magnesium sulfate, as in Epsom salts. I looked at him and said, like as in running through you like a dose of the salts? And he said, yes, absolutely. So I look on the bottle of water, and sure enough, there's magnesium sulfate in it, calcium carbonate, and other things. Now, it's an interesting story, but the amount of magnesium sulfate is so little. How could it upset your stomach? I just couldn't figure it out. And when I was told I was going to do this presentation and it was accepted, I said, you know, this is a good story. And the question is, how is this relevant? Well, we consume software. Our corporations are an organism. We live, we die with the software. Everything's there, and ultimately, it's the software we care about. And this software has unknown vulnerabilities, and sometimes we can get hacked through it. And if we don't know about these vulnerabilities in the software, well, we'll never get a clean cyber bill of health. And a lot of people say, it's important. Tell me where the water comes from. I mean, the software comes from. It doesn't really matter. It can come from anywhere. We don't care who has it. It can be commercial, open source, whatever. What we do care about is the security. I was walking through London a few years ago, and I saw this picture, and I thought, wow, this is incredible. This is our software paradigm. Everyone looks in one direction, and they're looking to ship date. That's all they're looking at. And occasionally, you'll have one person who's looking in the opposite direction and saying, wait a minute, what about security? Got to secure this thing. And that is what matters. Is it secure at the end of the day? When we look at software, we can't all be successful as Java. Java, 7 billion platforms. I mean, there's 97% of enterprises, 89% of the commercial installations in the U.S., computers in the U.S., have Java, 125 million computers. And if we look at the number of vulnerabilities since 2013, that's 612 vulnerabilities. You know, you can mess with my computers, but don't mess with my TV. The good news is we can track these vulnerabilities nowadays. We have a national vulnerability database. It's not magic, contrary to popular belief. You can go over and you can say, look at Java and see all the vulnerabilities. Great, no problem. And if we look, we've actually been doing really well with the vulnerabilities and tracking them. And you know, it's slowly but surely increasing, probably because we now know that vulnerabilities in software are a problem. Except for 2017, we see almost 2,700 new vulnerabilities in 2017. And this is a little bit of a surprise to 2014. It's a little bit of a surprise to us, but we all could pretty much figure out what happened, okay? SSL had Heartbleed in 2014, and that was a bad thing. There were, if you look at it, there are almost a billion systems, web servers out there, 900 million web servers, that run OpenSSL, okay? In 2014, CNN said, hey, 2/3 of the web servers are actually there running SSL, the other 1/3 are running something else, and this is okay. That means 600 and two-ish million machines have a vulnerability. But if you look, and we looked at the CVE chart, we see that there's only 32 vulnerabilities for OpenSSL. So how did we get 2,700 vulnerabilities? Well, let's think about this for a moment. Back up. When we get a product, we test it, we analyze it for vulnerabilities, we make sure that the product doesn't have any vulnerabilities we know about, but it's got components. And these components inside of our product are not necessarily visible. They might not even have a vulnerability when we release it or when we go and build it, put it into our infrastructure, but they may afterwards. Okay? So in 2014, the CVE spike was caused because people included OpenSSL technology in their product, but they couldn't attribute the vulnerability to OpenSSL because it was part of their product. So we have this big spike. So when you think about things like this, we tend to take product components and we bolt them onto the system, and we'll do them as an attachment. Those are easy to find, but what's not easy is when we take a product and we incorporate that product, and we include that product, and then you install it on your system. So you might not even know that you've got Apache in your infrastructure or OpenSSL in your infrastructure until it's too late. And just like the water in my case, it doesn't take a lot of vulnerabilities to cause you a problem. So there are some proposed solutions. We could talk about the government solutions, the government approaches, but you know, realistically, government getting it right first time, that's not going to happen. So I'm not going to waste time doing that. Just keep your eyes open. There may be stuff coming down. It'll be interesting. I want to talk about a technical approach to solving it. First, you've got the National Vulnerability Database, and that is all good. No problem. It works well. And you can identify products based on the National Software Reference Library. Great technology, great stuff. You can actually start looking at components to a certain level if you know you've got the components. Now, the issue is you don't know you've got these components. Sometimes they're embedded. They're embedded like five layers deep, and you're looking and going, wait a minute, this doesn't make sense. How can we do this? So these are some tricks that you can actually use to figure out what you're doing or what software has been installed on your infrastructure. You can actually look at the bill of materials, the installer, and say, hey, let me see which components you're laying down and then look at them. Look for copyright statements in them. Look for trademarks, version information, third-party license files, hashes. Figure out what components are actually embedded in the products. It's fairly easy to do. And assuming you get all those components identified with a name, an origin, a version, you can then associate them to that product. So when a vulnerability comes out for a component, all you have to do is look and say, oh, wait a minute, I'm using that vulnerability in this product. Well, that component with that vulnerability in this product. So when you think about it, you know, this is all easily done by hand. And we all know we've got millions of hours of free time because after all, the Java and the TV crashed. So we can actually sit there and we can do this all by hand and it's not a problem, right? What we really need to do is we really need a tool. We need to have a tool that can actually go and cross-reference the software to the vulnerability. So if I have, you know, JBoss, for example, and it's got a vulnerability, I don't know I've got JBoss in my infrastructure, well, what am I going to do? Well, I'll look at my program list and then say, oh, JBoss is in there, and then I can turn around and say, yes, this is a problem. So if you have a tool, you can actually go ahead and use the tool. So in this case, I created a very simple tool, and all it does is it says, here is the product, here are the third-party components, and it associates the components to the product. Now, this really isn't that useful, except for the fact you have an inventory mechanism. If you turn around and you then say, well, wait a minute, I've got JBoss, show me all the products that have JBoss in it, then it really is useful. And then I can start looking at the vulnerabilities associated with JBoss, and this is great, right? Well, sort of. Where I really want to be is I want to be able to go and start up the program, and I want to see what third-party components are embedded in my environment. Sure, I've got that. But more importantly, I want to look at those vulnerabilities and see what components they're tagged to, and I want it automatically to look at my environment and say, hey, here's this product, here's that product, and you might want to go and look at it. And ideally, in my world, I'll generate a bug report. In your world, you might generate a mail message to your engineering team and say, hey guys, go take a look at this product. It's got this vulnerability, maybe, sort of, kind of, okay? There is one thing to be cautious of. You can overwhelm your entire organization by saying, hey, I got this vulnerability. And then it's not a vulnerability. So the next time you send a mail message out, hey, this vulnerability exists. Not all vulnerabilities are going to be meaningful in your environment. Not every CVE is going to be meaningful. So what you really want to do is you really want to look at a way to mark the vulnerability as being relevant, not relevant, or being an investigation. Being an investigation is an important phase that people usually forget. I'm looking at the vulnerability. I want to make sure that the vulnerability isn't really impacting me. If it's impacting me, I'm going to flag it. Okay. The second thing you're going to want to do is you're going to want to say, hey, the vulnerability is mitigated, or it's not mitigated. Okay. Or there's no mitigation needed. If it's no mitigation needed, you should flag it as that. Why? Because someone's going to say, hey, there's maybe this vulnerability. What do we got to do? Okay, so let's recap for a second. So look at the resources I point to in the beginning of the presentation and go out, and this isn't rocket science. This isn't, you know, that difficult to do. Go out and create a tool, okay? The tool is very easy to do. You know what the basic structure is. We're not victims here. We can actually go and make this happen. The CVE format is published, and it works very well. And it enables you to triage your communication and your potential issues. So go out, spread the word, and remember, don't poison your infrastructure or your organization with bad components. Thank you.